Hi, I'm Lisa Bisbee, and I'm an artist, and I'm reading Art and Man. And on the 22nd, October, 1 p.m., I am going to be having an online class. So get ready for the information, and I'll send you more maybe tomorrow. Okay, so we're at Chapter 3, Evolution of the Artist, Instinct and Impulse and Patronage. Among every agglomeration of men, call we them as we prefer, races or peoples or nations or tribes or clans or families, we find art. Art is infinite in its varieties, and it is not identical in any two localities. It is not identical at any two periods, but the rule seems to be absolute that in every clime, at every time, among every tribe, we find art in some form or shape. Art is not universal among persons. In fact, it crops out strongly, only sporadically among individuals. But it is universal in man racially, since it is found everywhere. And how can this be accounted for? Apparently, there is but one answer, which is that an instinct to like art and an impulse to make art is ingrained in many members of the human family. The art instinct might be defined as a love for an observation of form and color. It is not a seeking after intellectual thoughts and ideas. It is a purely human instinct, as no quadruped, except that in a few cases some animals seem to distinguish differences in colors, ever showed the faintest glimmer of it. It varies with different peoples, different periods, different circumstances, and different environments. Nevertheless, it is always the same thing, a love of form and color, a product of the same emotions cropping out in different ways, a mental ability to appreciate and enjoy the craftsmanship and accomplishments of other artists. The art impulse might be defined as the desire to express and make visible the feelings aroused by the art instinct. When the art instinct and the art impulse are found in the same person, that person may become an artist. This instinct, which appears among all races of men, is the same as and is usually called the aesthetic sense. Certain members of all races appear to have this aesthetic sense, and those who have it are the ones who want to paint or sculpt. They are the men who, because forms and colors appeal to their artistic or aesthetic faculties, try to reproduce in painting or sculpture men or animals or landscapes, or who like to decorate their persons and possessions with patterns and designs. The art instinct might be called a primal instinct in man. It is certainly universal, as people made or make art in every part of the world. It seems to spring up instinctively and naturally among men, much as does the instant speech. Indeed, art itself is a mode of human expression, just as is language. In fact, one might say, art is perhaps the most universal of languages. There is certainly a universal instinct to make art. Does this instinct grow up everywhere of its own accord? Or is it a transmitted quality? An answer to this psychological question might help towards solving the problem, whether art throughout the world is all one art or whether there are many arts. All art has its roots in and evolves from an art instinct and art impulse. That is from the enjoyment and desire to produce things seen by the eye. All the beginnings of every art must spring originally from an art instinct and an art impulse based on vision. That art instinct and art impulse were born once and since then transmitted to man everywhere is manifestly impossible. On the contrary, it appears self-evident that the art instinct has been born over and over again with the individuals themselves who have applied it because they also had the impulse. It is therefore more probable, on the whole that races like the Eskimo or the Milesians were impelled by their own feelings and went on to work to make some art of their own in their own way, much as a bird sits on a branch and sings, rather than that different tribes or races should have inherited qualities descended among all men generation by generation. The art of the European Pleistocenes is the earliest art known to us. Excuse me. Admitting that it is the oldest art implies that it could not have been influenced by any other art, and therefore it must have sprung solely from an art instinct and art impulse. It must have begun in some of the Pleistocenes becoming interested in things that they actually saw and a desire to mimic these things being aroused. The observation and attempted imitation of the animals and men of the Pleistocenes looked at around them must have been the elemental factors in the start of naturalistic art. Decorative art appears to be due, in the main, to an innocent desire to play with lines and colors. Some of it is a degeneration of naturalistic art, but some of it does not imitate anything in nature. Many people love bright colors and make use of them simply because they do like them without any meaning behind them. This may not result in art, or perhaps only in the crudest art, but the impulse which prompts applying patches of bright color in any way to things is really a result of the art instinct. That the aesthetic sense is the underlying motive power, the art impulse, of all artists in the glyptic arts is easily seen in the proclivities of some young children to make pictures. Their first artwork is observing and trying to delineate in some way what they see because they like to do it. It is the art instinct, working crudely, which finds expression in the pictures made by children. At 4 or 5 years of age, if a boy has gifts of a sculptor, he probably makes pretty mud pies. Well, if he is cut out for a future painter, he begins to draw pictures of men or houses or cats on the sidewalk. It is this desire to imitate, to reproduce figures or scenes he observes, which eventually leads to an older child to become an artist. If he does not have this faculty, he turns to some other work, never to art. The recognition of this underlying impulse among children is of great importance when seeking the starting point of the arts of primitive peoples, of the Congo Africans, the Papuans, and the Amazon Amerinds, etc. Their minds in many ways appear to act much like the minds of children of advanced races. I don't like that term, advanced races. And it seems, therefore, prima facie, probable that their wooden figurines in most cases are simply the outcome of their aesthetic desire to reproduce the human form. But while all art apparently appears to spring primarily from an art instinct, depending on the sense of vision, some art proceeds secondarily from an attempt to visualize mental conceptions. This sometimes brings forth good results, but sometimes it proves dire failures in which it is difficult to perceive any art impulse due to the eye. The Neolithic European peoples, for instance, left a great many pieces of pottery whose upper parts vaguely resemble an owl's head. Whether, as some ethnologists believe, these potteries personate some female anthropomorphic divinity, or whether they do not, and whether they are or are not decorative degenerations. It is difficult to associate a genuine ocular art impulse with the specimens themselves. The artist's impulse is not unlike that of a good mouse or cat, which, as soon as its eyes are opened, goes for the first mouse it sees. The artist's impulse might also be likened to that of a spider, when it makes its web a wonderful and beautiful piece of work, which the spider, untrained and untaught, makes by its natural instinct and impulse. Why does a duck take to water? Why do little cackling ducklings hatch from a hen waddle off from their distracted foster mother to go swimming on the farmyard puddle? And the answer is because it is their nature too. Instinct impels them to go swimming, and it is the same with the real artist. His instinct drives him to art just as the cat's instinct prompts him it to catch mice, just as the duck's instinct drives it to water. And all the best art of the world comes from this impulse, and in many cases, the artists do not know exactly how they do their work and are unable to teach others. They simply do as they do because it is their nature to. Certain men have the art instinct so strongly developed as to overbalance the reasoning powers. Things seen, the glyptic rudimentary art sense, and not things heard or things thought out, control them. The art genius of such men sometimes dominates and stalks away with them so completely that in the everyday, commonplace affairs of life, they act in the strangest way and are considered eccentric, if not insane. These men must follow their instinct. They do not reason about art in general, they just do. They cannot tell others why they do or how they do, but they do. This does not mean that the artist never reasoned. On the contrary, some of the best intellects, thanks, Bear City Impact. I'm off the page. Okay, this does not mean that the artist never reasoned. On the contrary, some of the best intellects in the world have been painters or sculptors or musicians. As for instance, Leonardo da Vinci, Rubens, and Hector Berlioz. Leonardo was a great engineer and a good geographer. Rubens was as polished a courtier and diplomat as ever lived. Berlioz was a witty and incisive writer. These men and a great many others also used their minds and reasoned out all they could of the principles of their art. The best painting is not all instinct. The best paintings show knowledge of composition, masses, values, harmony, etc. Without the art instinct, these would be useless. With the instinct added, great work is sometimes produced. It is the same with music. A knowledge of harmony, counterpoint, fugue, etc. is necessary. But the gift of melody, the underlying musical instinct, is imperative. And how few composers have had the real gift. Turner may be taken as a type of thorough artist. He lived in a little, dirty, uncomfortable London suburban home. After his father's death, he had no one with him but an old, ignorant housekeeper. But he lived in a world of dreams. He probably never noticed his surroundings. He saw visions of rainbows and breaking waves and rising suns, and he transferred those visions to the most heavenly landscapes ever shown to the world. His art instinct obliterated the man. He was uneducated, gruff, unsociable, and illiterate. But what difference does it make if Turner, in his everyday life, often acted like a bear with a sore head? Since he transposed for us the facts of nature into the dreamland of Turneria. Richard Wagner is another artist who may be mentioned here, since his many scenic effects fall within the confines of pictorial art. He was eccentric. Some of his biographers have said hard things about him. He is reported to have stood on his head whilst leading the rehearsal for a concert. The fact of the matter is that Wagner had an abnormal brain. As an ordinary person, he was a little mad. A man who could hear the Liebestod or the Pilgrim's Chorus or the Funeral March singing in his brain could not put on his clothes straight or talk like a boarder in a summer hotel. But his personal eccentricities do not alter the fact that Wagner was the most universally creative artist that ever lived. Besides the art instinct and impulse, which are driving powers within the artist himself, however, there is a great extraneous force which has much to do with shaping the lives and output of artists. When an artistic child begins to grow up, he may turn to art as a pursuit. If so, he tries at first to work in the field he enjoys the most, whether sculpture or painting or architecture, specializing besides in this whatever direction appeals to him most. If he is rich and ambitious, he may follow his own chosen path without hindrance. But if he is poor, and the majority of artists are poor, the need of finding food and shelter, that is the great extraneous force of struggle for existence and is bound to affect him. And the necessities for the life support he must obtain from the persons who will pay him for his artwork. These persons are spoken of as art patrons. And this artwork done for pay is descriptively termed by artists pot boiling. Pot boilers, in fact, represent a large part of art. Artists mainly spend their time in working at something which will enable them to live. In fact, they have to. They paint portraits of old gentlemen in black coats or illustrations, or they sculpt clocks and candelabras, or they erect skyscrapers, or in fact, they do something by which they can earn an honest penny. It is simply the working of the law of supply and demand. The customer wants some kind of artwork, and the artist does the rest. It is the stomach and not the brains of the artist which rules in this case, and not infrequently with dire consequences. Patronage, therefore, is really a main force in regard to the output in the fine arts. It is entirely distinct from the aesthetic sense. It is a hostile to it, in the sense that it forces many artists to work against the grain at things they do not care about, and it is largely responsible for much of the inartistic art of the world. It is an aid, however, to the artist in many cases in impelling them to work and produce something which, if perhaps not their best, is at least better than nothing. And in many cases, if it were not through the push of pot boiling, their artistic temperament would fritter itself away in laziness, and the artist accomplished less, in his favorite line, than he does through the stress of necessity in some direction he is not specially interested in. Wow, that was a quick chapter. Tomorrow we're going to be reading chapter 4. Have a great day, you all.